thank you. Oh, hello, world. What's up? Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Matt Forte, and we are here live at the Build Studio in New York City. For a little over a decade now, our next guests have been making some incredible music together. Their latest record, Love Is All You Love, is the powerful result of the group stepping outside their comfort zone and into some uncharted waters. They've expertly married their traditional live instrumentation with electronic elements for a new sound that, for them, is no doubt a little different, but is still distinctly Band of Skulls. Here to tell us how they did it, Russell Marsden and Emma Richardson are in the building. I'm excited. Are you excited? Let me hear a little bit of noise. I got to make sure. Let's go. You know, I said it back there. I'll say it again. Congratulations on this awesome, awesome record. I love the risks you guys were taking and all the experimenting you were doing, and I love how it still feels so much like your music. I'm excited to talk to you about it, but first and foremost, how the hell are you? How's life? How are you doing right now?
Doing good.
We're incredibly good.
Yeah, incredibly good to be back in New York.
Yeah,
that's great.
We're happy to be here. And yeah, exactly what you're saying. We did experimenting, you know, and we did take some risks, and that has kept it really exciting for us, so... This is the kind of the relief moment where those risks hopefully pay off. And
yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so.
Well, you just you got a chance. Was it your first time, I think, playing the new stuff in the States just a couple of nights ago? You've been playing it for months, but like the other night, Mercury Lounge, I think, is finally over here. And you guys played a show just a couple of nights ago, which must have been great energy in the room. What was that like?
It was cool. And also, the record's been out for a little while, so people get to hear it, and there was that kind of recognition. So we played a bunch of new songs. But yeah, it's our first show with our new drummer, Julian, in the States, officially. It just feels like it's been going on for a lot longer, but really, this is new. So.
How did you guys... you've known Julian for a while, right?
Yeah. I feel bad talking about him when he's not here to defend himself.
We're going to say nice things.
He's the best person I've ever met in the world.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Julian, huge fan of the show, so we know he's watching right now.
So Julian, this one's for you. We're old friends from our first album tour with the Wigs. And he fits in really nicely. And he's in Nashville. Right now, he's just back at the hotel, but he's in Nashville, not me. So we did some recording there as well with him. So this has been a kind of collaboration all around, really, this record.
Well, that was one of the things I was really excited to talk about in this record and just get into the process behind it. But starting at the very beginning, I'm curious, you know, when Matt left in 2016, you guys didn't have a drummer anymore. It was like, what dictated the path between let's experiment with new sounds entirely versus... Let's just get another drummer. Like what? You know, you could have gone one of two different ways. You could have just got another guy to keep playing drums and keep making the music you were making. But something in your brains and your hearts were like, well, you know, here's an opportunity. I'm just curious what pushed you in that direction.
It was an exciting time for us because we set up our own studios at home and we started writing quite quickly after that. And I think we were experimenting a lot with using different techniques for writing and working with more electronic kind of instruments as well as like live stuff. So
our neighbors hate us, you know. We went from just guitars to like drum machines and the whole nine yards. And we even like bought a drum kit. It was we kind of learned it from the ground up, and we got on the drum kit, and we got the Questlove drum kit. You know, the one that fits in the back of a car.
Right. Yeah.
Got that one.
Yeah.
And we just wrote some songs in a new way, just Emma and I in the studio, and it quickly moved on to then working with other people, with Richard, and then on to Nashville. Yeah.
We'll get to Richard in a little bit. How? What was the first song you guys wrote? Do you remember? I know it's hard to pinpoint, but like, was there a first track that you're like, oh?
Carnivorous.
First demo, and it kind of started off that whole idea of working in more of that way, and it was like, can we get away with doing this, basically?
Yeah. That was it. That was the game changer. We did that one and...
Set the tone.
Well, you can't really... You have to incorporate that into the record then, you know. We sort of made a statement with that and sent that out to our manager and then on to people that we wanted to work with. It's like, this is the kind of direction we feel we might take. And then the rest kind of happened naturally after that.
When you started reaching out to people and you were saying, this is... We're going to go in this new direction. What was the response mostly?
Don't do it.
No shit, really?
No,
don't?
There's a part of you that says, don't take a risk. Don't do it. It's like, play it safe. There's always that part of you. And we have that a little bit. And then you know, then it's like we don't get bored of what you do. Right. And also, we never really thought we'd be in this position where we're on our fifth album. You know, it was a conversation about what to do as we went forward and how to stay engaged with it, and also show the other music that we like listening to. Like, you know, it's not just rock and roll, but right. We tend to make a kind of rock and roll sound at the end of whatever we do. So. Yeah. It was just using some other influences. When we were in the studio, the first studio we went to with Richard actually was the old Chemical Brothers mixing room in London. So I feel like it was kind of in the back of our heads. We're like, let's make this. You know, the old Chemical Brothers records, they've got that kind of, they still rock out. They're kind of loud and abrasive. So
when I was young, they were some of the first, when I started like bleeding over out of rock, that they were kind of like my transitional right. stuff, because they did such a great job of having that vibe without, so it's such a cool energy.
Dig your own hole.
Dig your own hole.
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Block rock and beats.
Block rock and beats. Oh man, that song was everywhere.
Kind of rock song. Yeah, right.
Did you ever start to, was there a point, you know, prior to when you guys started playing it live that you weren't nervous anymore? Like, when did the nerves subside? when did you stop worrying?
When did it stop feeling
like a huge risk? Like, when did you realize, like, or did you not? You just had to commit to it.
I think when we started rehearsing with the new songs with Julian, he came over to our Southampton, our hometown, and we were getting the new songs ready to kind of go out and play them. And he's a brilliant drummer anyway, but it kind of, they fit into our set really well. And he, you know, they still have that kind of punch to them, and it's, you know, we're using the same equipment. It's the same sort of three-piece setup as we always have had, and they work well, you know.
We really thought we'd reinvent ourselves and be so different, and we turned up and did it, and we're like, oh yeah, it sounds like us.
Oh, all right, yeah.
So that's a good thing.
It was a lot more familiar, even though it's totally new. It felt a lot more familiar once you got to play
live.
Yeah,
at the other end of it, you know, the influences were a little different, and who we work with. Basically, we learned a lot, and in that collaborative place that we've tried to kind of carry on with now, working with lots of other different people, and just getting in like a learning curve out of our comfort zone, out of the kind of rock thing and into other worlds, you know, and learn something.
Totally. What was the emotion or the feeling going in to playing it live? Here's a bunch of music that's different in a way for you. It's more electronic based. Now I've got to bring that to the stage. Was there trepidation there? Like going into this, or once you had the drums, you're like, oh, it's.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. The one song that we had to change how we did it was Carnivorous.
Yeah.
So
that's funny.
This setup with just two mics is kind of what Emma and I have to just perform that song.
That's it.
And it's given us a great freedom to like maraud around the venue. And I think everyone was so shocked that we weren't playing guitars on a song. And there's that kind of fourth wall that no one thinks you're ever going to go through. And it's so fun just to leave the stage, leave the venue.
Yeah, I love a good chance to maraud around.
Yeah.
I'm always looking for that here, but it doesn't lend itself well to our format.
We could try it.
We could.
How far do these work?
You know, we've gone out to the street before. We've gone out to the sidewalk. So there's room to maraud. There certainly is. In all the experimenting with the new instruments and playing with the electronic sounds and stuff like that, did any of that excitement bleed over into how you guys tackled stuff that you played for years? So tackled your guitar, tackled your vocals. Did you start to look at that differently at all?
Yeah, I think we realized what Emma and I had. It's like what were the elements of the band that come from us. Mm-hmm. Just that, especially with like vocals and singing. And I guess what we wanted to do is really keep that going through the new songs. The last two songs we wrote, or the last bunch of songs we wrote, were the other two singles, Cool Your Battles and We're Alive. And those two really, we started to really remember what we do and how we write songs and how we arrange our voices and both sing at the same time, which is not what every band tends to do. So I think we learned a lot about that going forward. And then we started to sort of write some more guitar kind of songs. There's a song called Not the Kind of Nothing and then Love Is All You Love, that kind of, we fell back into our guitar place a little bit. Yeah. So the experiment was coming to a close and we kind of came back down from
kind
that.
Of big, yeah.
Yeah, so it was quite a cool.
Ideas. Let's just kind of tighten it up a
naturally
little bit.
Naturally kind of go back to some things that we kind of do naturally.
It seems like for an experimentation, for like all these different things that you're messing around with, there weren't any real like rules that you guys made or set in place, right? Like you just kind of allowed yourselves to really explore and try all these new things and just threw a lot of ideas at the wall and filtered them out. Or were there, am I wrong? Were there things like ground rules? Like
Not really. We never start with rules when we're writing, and I think it's kind of letting it kind of happen and pushing each other. It's, we have the kind of competition going on with like who can better each other's ideas, and but yeah, it was kind of best idea wins really, and we were yeah, like we said before, experimenting, writing in different ways, and it kind of just doing things we haven't done before and working with new people, and it sort of opens that sort of other world really, rather than, you know, we never used to collaborate with other people, so it was great to start working with Julian and Richard, and yeah.
I mean, there's even in our songwriting, I think some going down to like a songwriting duo, it opened up a lot of chances for us to, like, we both had to vote on the song and we just started to work a bit faster. And there are some songs that we've had for a while. There's a song that Emma had, which is now Sound of You, which she played when we walked in. And that song we've just never been able to finish for years, and it sat there like annoying us, you know? So frustrating to have this beautiful song and not finish it. And something changed, and we kind of found the key to unlock things like that. And
What led to your collaboration with Richard X? Was it a matter of, did you guys feel like you'd gone as far as the two of you could go, or were you at a place where you were like excited to bring someone like Richard? And just talk to me about how he came to be involved and what it was like.
Yeah, it was actually an idea we had from the record before, that we were supposed to meet him, and that didn't work out. So it was like it was a second chance to meet someone, and he still wanted to meet us and wasn't offended. And
that's always nice.
So yeah, it was cool. So we got together and he really taught us how he goes about writing songs. And one of the things he would do is like put us in a real, like, out of our comfort zone, like throw the mic to you and say, sing a song, and like it's recording and you've not prepared anything. And just
any of that make it to the record?
All of it. Yeah, no, that's the whole record.
Really? That was how he was doing it.
So like, well, we had a song called Gold that we did like that, and a bunch of other ones. And then when we left Richard, we started using that technique ourselves, like showing up to our own studio and saying, right, let's write a song today, and just press record. So no practice, no like preparing and getting into those kind of, again, into that comfort zone, and just take one take, you know? And often you can get the vibe of something at least in that first take. So we learned a lot from him. Although I really hated him at the time, because you feel really embarrassed, but you're sort of singing nonsense basically into really expensive sound equipment.
The really expensive sound equipment helps. It makes it a little less embarrassing.
No,
right?
It makes it like the finest detail of a bad idea, you know?
It's like, magnified.
Yeah, it's terrible.
How many, how much hit the cutting room floor, or is this every idea that you guys have? Was there a lot of stuff that didn't make the record? Or was it?
Pretty much everything.
Everything's
we were doing. And there's like three extra tracks that we did with him.
Cool.
That were a bit darker and a bit more kind of exploratory. And I guess we just didn't choose them for the main album because they were a little bit more like a darker vibe. We wanted a real, like, uplifting, euphoric record that every song had a positive kind of vibe and message.
Totally, yeah.
So, but they were interesting too, and there's lots of other ideas that we didn't bring to Richard because they were like even darker, you know. So maybe we'll do. I think in a way our records are like that. We have a kind of a uplifting record, then a kind of a
that's what I was curious
a dark
about.
And mysterious one, it seems. So
yeah, like with the pattern, like the pendulum swinging one way to the other. And I was really curious, after you've done all this, you've found this sound, you've honed this sound. Are you going to hang out here in this world for a little bit? I know it's early to say, you guys are still touring on this record, but like I'm sure you've thought about, you know, the next one on a roadmap. Do you think you'd depart yet again, or do you kind of see yourself hanging out in this area for a little bit with these vibes, or do you want to try something even more new? What are you thinking?
I think it will probably change again, but I mean it's hard to predict. But I mean we're obviously we're already thinking about the next record. Part of us kind of wants to keep it quite raw and real, but we who knows what's going to happen? I think it's going to be great. We're going to be coming back in the fall to tour America, so it's going to be we'll get some.
Yeah, by then we'll be like getting into the making of the next thing. You know how it goes. So I think we just don't want to repeat ourselves. So we're probably moving on already without knowing it. And if we do anything like this, we'll probably just do it on the side or collaborate with other people. I think, it's great to have, I think more and more it's nice to have outlets for different musical ideas. And it's quite hard for any band to have to wait two or three years to put out 10 songs. Right. and that's your only chance to say something. So, yeah, it'd be nice to sort of, if you have some more crazy experiment ideas, just to put them out there in different ways.
It's a great time for you guys right now. You've got this amazing tour in front of you. It's also, this particular year is the 10-year anniversary of your debut record.
I heard that in the intro. Yeah. For nearly a decade. I thought you had the wrong guests coming out.
No, but is that not true? I mean,
it's true. It's just terrifying.
And I phrase it that way because I honestly, in doing the research, I knew the record was 10 years ago, but I didn't know how much, just because the record was 10 years ago, you guys have been working for more than that. You had to put in time before your debut album, but I didn't know the exact amount of time, so yeah. I kept it vague.
It's true, though, yeah. It's amazing. We're just amazed that that's happened.
Yeah.
And then we've got to this album, and that record is 10 years old, and people have been listening to it for that amount of time. And it's got that, it's like a birthday. And it's, yeah. I mean, it was amazing for us to make a record in the first place, you know, and that's what everyone dreams of doing. So to get to this, it's a milestone for the record. And we're going to re-release the album. I think we only made a bunch of copies at the beginning, so we're going to make a really nice package and also do some special shows. We're going to be playing here in the city and doing playing the album in its entirety, actually.
Oh, no way. Is that for the fall?
That's in the fall. So that's the Webster Hall.
Yeah. Oh, so, man, that's going to be badass.
It's going to be cool.
You guys are going to, you're ridiculously busy. I know you're just after this, I think on Monday you're playing in L.A., right? You got a show in L.A. on the West Coast. I saw that. And then you go back and you're doing some European dates.
We got some festivals coming
up. And then you're back here in the fall.
Yeah, back here. Kind of a doubleheader with the new album and the old album on the same tour. Really.
Is that going to be? Have you already talked about set list? How are you just going to do one album, break the other album? Or are you going to intermingle? What are you thinking? Like,
I reckon the first album. What do you think?
Yeah, we need to play the whole of the first record, I think,
and then play it front to back.
Yeah.
But the track list on the first record is like all the singles are like at the front, so it's going to be a really strange show. It's going to be front loaded. So that's going to be interesting.
What's really interesting, though, is that that's true. You got the singles at the front, but that when an album is out and people are listening to it for 10 years, the idea of a single kind of, it doesn't matter anymore. It's more about, the transitions between songs. When one song ends, you're expecting what comes next. I think it's going to be a fun ride. I always love when a band does that, when they take an album that I've, listened to a lot and they give me the whole thing live. It's a fun experience.
It'll be really interesting for us as well to do. Yeah, and there's a bunch of songs that we can do on the second. I'm not sure if we're going to have it's going to be a really big encore, basically. It's going to be like an hour encore. Yeah.
It's a long encore. We're going to go to the audience in just a second. I got two questions. Perfect. We'll go out there in a moment. But I didn't want to leave this without talking about also, we saw the video for Love Is All You Love, but it's part of, and keep me honest here, it's a trilogy of videos, right? Because I was watching them on YouTube, and they're all kind of interconnected, your three singles. Was that something you guys had conceived of, or is that another awesome collaboration where somebody had this great idea and you kind of went for it?
Yeah, kind of both. It was something we wanted to do, and this guy, Nate Campone, came up with the awesome idea of what you've seen there, so we worked with him on it.
Yeah, he sent us the treatment, and it was like, this is perfect. This is exactly what will work for these three songs. It looked striking, and he brought in an amazing cast of actors, and they were fighting and dancing, and
Was it all filmed at once, like composed as one large piece? Is that how they did it?
Yeah, it was over a couple of days in Manchester.
Wow.
And
in the coldest warehouse of all time, the cast were like, there was a ballerina and a boxer and some dancers, and that people were like, they laid some rubble down. People were fighting, and some people had to go to the emergency room. And
no way.
They were getting really involved. It was a wicked thing. Yeah, it was cool. And we just did the singing part. We did nothing really. the video is really cool, and it kind of loops around. We'd like the idea because sometimes the videos do feel a bit separate from different songs, and it just added another layer to the music that we didn't really conceive of. So it's cool to see someone else's take on your work, and especially with the lyrics. So.
Yeah.
It was a cool thing.
The circuitous nature of it is very cool. The way it all kind of loops around and connects to each other.
Thanks.
Really neat. All right. Getting the signal. Got to turn it over. We got a couple of questions in the room. Let's go to the first one right over here.
Hi, guys. So we have a question from our site, buildseries.com. And it's, are there current artists that you're listening to that have inspired you for this album?
Emma?
Current. Well, current. Very
current. Yeah, we said the old records,
I'm listening to a band at the moment. They're called Easy Life, and I think they've only released a few EPs, but check them out. They're amazing. I don't know if they've influenced us in making our record, but definitely new favorite band here.
Cool. Yeah. And I saw the band. What's the? I get the pronunciation wrong all the time. Pitbloom.
Yeah.
Pitbloom, who are from Amsterdam. It's like a kind of girl Nirvana.
Oh, cool.
But like super uplifting. And I saw them after we made the record. But they have this energy that it's just really great. And I think I appreciate that positive, like up energy. So they're really, watch out for those guys too. They're cool.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Great question. Putting out a record that is positive, that has all this up energy, as you've been playing it, has there been a tangible shift in the energy at your shows? Like, do you feel like the music is influencing the overall vibe in the room because it's positive and because it's optimistic in some cases in what you guys are talking about?
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. I think we have, you know, you have a new audience coming. You recognize people that have come to your shows for a long time, and you know, they have like the T-shirt from this show, and you remember they have a memory of seeing you at this festival.
Totally.
And you also see people that are coming for the first time, and they're not really judging your music on when they first heard an old record. They're just getting into you now, and so it's cool.
Yeah.
We started our tour in our hometown of Southampton, and we rented this church, and put a huge PA system in the church, and. Which is it was awesome because most
of
the audience.
What did that sound like?
It sounded very loud. I think we might have damaged the structural integrity of the building. But the audience was a new audience. You know, we've grown up there, so when you don't recognize people at your hometown show, it shows that your new music can reach a new audience. Hopefully.
That's so ridiculously cool. I love that. I got time for one more. Let's bring it up. One more question. Who do we got? All the way in the back.
Hi, you guys talked a lot about the people you collaborated with on this album and albums in the past. Is there any like new artists you guys want to collaborate with? Or not even new artists, just any artists you want to collaborate with in the future that you've been thinking about for a long time?
Yeah, more collaborations.
More collaborations.
Who's in the sights? Who's next?
I'm not sure, but we recently worked with a band called Archive, and we've collaborated on a song with them, which was really exciting to do. There's a great artist called Mickey Echo as well.
Oh, yeah. So we did a track with Mickey.
Yeah.
That's not out yet. That's coming out soon.
Very exciting.
That was cool.
Yeah?
We did a very old song, and he made it sound very, like, not old, basically. Very futuristic.
Love it.
And, so I think anyone that's really, like, a different artist to us, so want to keep learning. And basically, if we're scared at the session, then we know it's going well. Yeah. So, I don't know. We just like to, especially like new artists that are just emerging, it'd be cool just to work with people that have just, you know, we've not heard of yet. Like, I'm just always looking out for new things happening and just learning still, you know.
Did you bring Mickey in, try that microphone trick, throw a mic at him, go record? And he's like, what the hell are you doing, man?
He's got a whole other technique, which is equally as terrifying.
What does he do?
He put me through a kind of a method acting thing where... I sang the song, and then I sang it, 10 more times? And by the end, I was just a wreck.
Yeah.
I don't know who I was anymore. We hugged, and then he used the first take.
So, oh, brutal.
Yeah. But somewhere out there is me losing my mind singing this song. But yeah, we bonded on that one.
And
He's a great singer. He's the greatest singer.
Yeah, he knew all along it was take number one.
I think he might have done, yeah.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah. Sadly, I got to wrap things up. I got to let you guys go. You have a trillion other things to go do, but I'll say it again. Congratulations. I know it's been out for a minute, but it's a fantastic record, and there's a lot to be proud of there, man.
Thank you very much.
I wish you the best of luck on all the tours that you got coming up. You're going to be all over the globe, but there's so much going on. Bandofskulls.com is a great resource. The record's available everywhere. If you go to their site, you can find out everywhere they're going to be playing. You can get tickets. You can be in the loop, as you should be. And everybody do me a favor. Make a ridiculous amount of noise. Join me once again thanking Band of Skulls, Russell Marsden, and Emma Richardson for being here.